but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Hey, oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Man, why don't we all stand together? Amen. It's so good to have everybody back here on this Sunday evening for church. I don't know about you, but I'm ready to see what the Lord has in store for us. Amen. We had a great time here this morning, and my wife spoke to us just an awesome word about the spirit of a sound mind. And I don't know about you, but I want that spirit activated in my life. Amen. I want the Lord to have his way. And it's so good to have all of you with us. Our guests, thank you so much for being with us. Amen. It's good to have you with us. Can we let our guests know how much we appreciate them being with us? Amen. Can we just turn our hands and turn our eyes and our hearts toward heaven right now and just ask the Lord to have his way in this service? Lord, we're trusting you to do what only you can do, Lord. You know, Lord, everything that's going to be represented in this service, every need, Lord, every situation. And Lord, right now, as we start this service, Lord, we are turning it all to you and we are giving it to you. God, I pray, Lord, that you would let your will be done. Don't let one person leave tonight untouched or unchanged by the presence, Lord, by the name that's above every name, that it's in the name of Jesus, Lord, that we're declaring your will be done in this service. Amen. Let's give the Lord another hand clap of praise and worship him in song.
The keys to do the same. You hold redemption.
Can we do that right now with our worship? God, we echo your authority. When our praises go up, Lord, we're declaring that your glory is going to come down. That we will see a victory, oh God.
Belongs to you, Lord.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does. Come on, let's worship him. Come on, if you want to see a victory tonight, all you got to do is just recognize the Lord. The battle's not mine, but it's yours tonight. Come on, let's worship him right now. God, we thank you that you can turn things back around in our life. Thank you, Jesus. The enemy thought he had you, but the Lord turned it back around. Amen. The psalmist said, when the captivity of Zion was turned again. Amen. It doesn't matter what season you're in right now, the Lord can turn it around. Amen. There needs to be some returning. Amen. Somebody say, praise the Lord. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer tonight again. So good to have all of you, and it's so good to have Brother and Sister Tony with us. We'll be saying more about that later, but thank you all so much for being here. Amen. I know there are many needs that would, if we were to pass the mic around, no doubt that you would have. Amen. But the bottom line is we serve a God that's able. And that's all we need to know. He is able. And but it is so good to have all of you with us. It's good to have our guest ministers with us, Brother Ethan, Sister Cassidy Doyle, Assistant Brother Nicholas Robbins there at Life Point. It's good to have them with us. Good to have Brother Devin Cook with us, our Section 1 Youth Director. Amen. Proud of the work that he is doing for our youth. And Brother and Sister Hysall, good to have y'all with us. And amen. The Borens, good to have y'all with us. God is so good. Amen. Amen. And so as we take knees before the Lord, amen, let's just do it like this. If you have a need or if you know of a need, would you just lift your hand? Amen. If you need to, if you want to share it with somebody near you, you can agree with a brother or sister. Amen. But can we lift these needs up? Come on, there are some serious needs. We want to continue praying for those unable to come to church because of health reasons. Amen. Let's lift them up in prayer. God, you're so good. God, we're believing, Lord, that you're going to let healing take place. Lord, and those that's not able to be here because of sickness, Lord, those that would like to be here but can't be, I pray, Lord, that you can let them feel what we feel in this sanctuary, in their home, Lord, in the nursing home room, in the hospital room, wherever they may be. God, I pray, Lord, that your will would be done in this service tonight, God. Let your anointing, Lord, not just show up, but let us recognize it and respond to what you want to do in this place tonight. God, I pray, Lord, that nobody leaves the same tonight, but let us leave strengthened and encouraged, God. Let us leave tonight, Lord, with a fresh determination and a fresh boldness, God, that we're going to serve you with gladness and we're going to serve you, Lord, with expectancy. God, that we're going to see greater things, Lord, in every church, God, God, in every family, in every home, oh, God. In Jesus' name, if you believe that, would you give the Lord a hand clap of praise? God, we're going to see revival. We're going to see it. Above all other names, everybody just to begin to call upon the name of Jesus.
I am forgiven. Yes, fear has to leave. Strongholds are broken. I've been made free. I am forgiven. Fear has to leave. Your name is healing. Your name is power. Your name is holy. Strong powers, wonderful name, glorious name, powerful name.
Testimony that He is your healer, He is your protector, He is your provider, He is your everything. Would you just magnify Him right now? Thank you, Jesus. Come on, somebody's going to overcome tonight, not just by the blood, but the word of your testimony in your praise and in your worship. God, here I am, God, to say that you are my everything. Yes, you are. Somebody say praise the Lord. Amen. Remain standing if you will at this time. Brother Tyler Hassall is going to come and share with us a ministry minute. Amen. And I would appreciate Brother Tyler, Sister Katie Hassall. They are our youth pastors here at the church and do a fabulous job with our young people. But I want him to come and bless us tonight with a word the Lord's laid on his heart.
Amen. Y'all can be seated for a quick second. He said a minute, so. That usually means about 15. I'm just playing. But what I would like to talk to you for at least 1 minute tonight is this right here. Strength means nothing without faith. And that can go so many ways. But what I'm going to be focused on is 1 Samuel chapter 9 and verse 2. This is when we hear about Saul, who was soon to be anointed king. And this verse describes it. It says, and he had a son whose name was Saul, a young man and a goodly. And there was not among the children of Israel a goodlier person, a gooder person than he. Some of y'all are cringing out there, I know it. But from his shoulders and upward was he taller than any of the people. Saul, no doubt, was a stronger man. Usually, when you're bigger than everybody else around you, usually you're stronger than everybody else around you. Amen. Usually. And so here we see that Saul is shoulders above everyone around him. And if we read on to the next 4 or 5 chapters, we get a word from God here that was told Saul. He wants to go destroy the Amalekites. But Saul, being his strength, said, you know, no, I know you told me to do this and I will do it, but I think my way just might be a little better. He had some strength about him. And the verse says, and Saul gathered the people together and hunt and numbered them in Telaim, 200,000 footmen and 10,000 men of Judah. That's a lot of strength. That's a lot of army. But if we read on, it says, but Saul and the people spared Agag and the best of the sheep and of the oxen and of the fatlings and of the lambs and all that was good, and would not utterly destroy them. But everything that was vile and refuse that they destroyed utterly. You see, we thought Saul thought he had it all together. He thought he'd done all the good things because he had his strength, his army. He had a plan. God told him what to do, but he had a slightly better idea. And if we read on, it says that when Samuel came to confront him about it, he said, well, we left the good for sacrifice to God. We left the best for God. And Samuel said, hath the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of the rams. And as Samuel turned about to go away, he laid hold upon the skirt of his mantle, and it rent. And Samuel said unto him, the Lord hath rent the kingdom of Israel from thee this day, and hath given it to a neighbor of thine that is better than you. I'm telling you right now, I don't want God to look at me and say, I've got what you have. I'm going to give it somebody better than you. I don't want to think I've got it all together. I don't want my strength to get in the way. Well, you may say, that's not me. I wouldn't do that. But have you ever been that person whose prayer life is lacking until you find yourself in a situation where your strength cannot get you any further? Hallelujah. I'm talking to myself sometimes. I'm telling you, sometimes I lack in my prayer life. I do, and I try and I struggle, but sometimes I let life get in the way. But guess what? When the storm started getting worse, I started praying at a time I normally don't, saying, God, don't let the power go out. See, my strength couldn't keep the power on. But I started praying for him anyway. We got to quit letting our faith supplement our strength. We got to let our strength supplement our faith. God said, I don't call you that are equipped, I equip the called. Whatever God has for you, whatever he's got for you to do, do it. He will provide. Don't let your ideas and better ways you think you can make the situation go. Don't let that get in the way. I'm telling you. Let your strength supplement your faith. I'm telling you tonight. He's here. There is no way you should leave the same. Amen. A lot of times we think we're better than everybody else because we're not dealing with that person's dealing with. I'm telling you, we are no better than anybody else in this room. Amen. Like Sister Solomon talked about this morning, God has given us the spirit of love. We got to love everybody, no matter how strong we think we are. No matter how weak we think everybody else around us is. No matter how much we think our faith is better than the next person. If we give it to God, everything, he'll give it back and then some. Amen. Don't let your faith supplement your strength, but let your strength supplement your faith. Amen. Bless up.
And the church said amen. How many of you want God's will for your life? Well, his will is found in his way. Amen. So if I want his will, I want to make sure to do it God's way. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, Brother Tyler, for sharing that with us. At this time, I want Brother and Sister Hysall to be coming and getting ready to sing for us. As they're coming, I want to make just a few announcements. Again, so good to have all of you with us. This is for our local church, these announcements. And if you have another announcement, Brother Cook, when's our next Section 1 youth rally? Thursday and Friday. That's right, because we're going to be out of town. We're going to miss it. So, hey, my wife and I, but we want our young people to be there this Thursday and Friday night. And Brother Sammy Sher. So we got an awesome weekend for our young people. And that's also not just for our young people. It's for any of our church people that would like to go. Feel free. And it's going to be at? Pleasant Hill. Brother Kirk's there in Corinth, and so we want to support that. So remember that, all of our young people. If you haven't got your candy ground picked up yet from this morning, I believe Sister Tina can still hand those out to you if you want to get those tonight. And so see her. I believe the youth have sold out of coffee. I got the last three bags of it this afternoon. That is some good stuff. If you haven't had any of that Kingdom coffee, you are missing out. But don't forget, ladies, Zoom Bible study Tuesday night at 7 p.m. And then back here in the sanctuary Wednesday night, we're going to have Bible study, children's church, youth service. So we invite all of you to come be with us Wednesday at 7. And then ladies' prayers Thursday morning at 8 o'clock. Bible quiz and practice will be Thursday evening at 6:30. Ushers, if you would, go ahead and come. Prepare to wait on us for our Sunday evening tithes and offering. Everybody say next Sunday. Next Sunday we have a morning service only. It's the last Sunday of the month. And so we want to invite you to come be with us at 10 o'clock in the morning. Brother Kerry Miller is going to be speaking here next Sunday morning, so you don't want to miss that. It'll be such a blessing. Amen. Why don't we all stand together again? It's so easy to reach into your purses and your wallets when you're standing up. And again, we are just delighted to have you with us. We started doing something a little while ago. I don't know how you've been doing it at your church, but since all this COVID business hit, up until about 2 or 3 weeks ago, we just had the bucket set in the back where people could give as they come in and leave out. And a couple of weeks ago, we started just doing a good old offering march. And so this isn't just for offering, it's just a good time of visitation. So if you want to get out in the aisle a little bit, go see somebody, meet somebody you haven't had an opportunity to introduce yourself to. And we're going to just take a moment as the high sauls bless us in song. Amen. God bless you. Anybody willing to say, Lord, I'll provide the sacrifice? Amen. I promise you, he'll provide the fire. Amen, amen, amen. We're going to sing another song as we prepare for the word of the Lord. Again, all of you that are here tonight, thank you so much, Brother Billy Patton. Thank you so much for being with us. Amen. And I'm going to go ahead and introduce Brother Tony, and then after we sing this song, I'm going to let him just come on up, if that's all right. And it is an honor. I tell you what, why don't you just be seated? I got something to say. It is a high honor to have he and Sister Tony in Boonville tonight. And it was in 2006 when I started dating my wife again, the 12th time. But I was initially planning on moving her back to Mississippi, and she was out in Omaha helping Brother and Sister Tony, and just began to pray about some things. And I was at a place of transition in my own life and ministry, and just felt the Lord lead us out to Nebraska to be with them. And they opened up their home to me for a couple of months while I was looking for a place to live before my wife and I got married, and didn't know me from anybody. They just knew my wife, and I guess they trusted her a little bit. But they did open up their home for me, and it's been a pleasure to serve alongside them and with them during different things in different places. And they have planted two churches, one in Omaha, Nebraska, one in Lexington, Kentucky, and those churches are still going strong. And so we give God praise for that. He has served in many capacities in the district of Nebraska while he was there as a district youth president, I believe, and district secretary, and fixed all kind of stuff. But he also served as the director of North American Missions for the UPCI headquarters and did a great job there, and set some programs in place that are still being utilized today for great growth in our church planters and encouragement to them. And they currently pastor in a church somewhere in Florida called Gainesville, Florida, the Pentecostals of Gainesville. And all the positions that I just listed and that I named that they've done and they've held, that means a little bit to me, but not a whole lot. The biggest thing that I guess the highest honor for me is that I can call them pastor and I can call them friend. And it means the world to us, the influence that they've had in our lives. Not just me, but my wife. They had her for a lot longer. They working on her, and every now and then he'll call and say, "You got anything else you need me to do?" And because y'all know this morning, she's the pastor of this church. Y'all haven't figured that out yet. But didn't she do a great job this morning? I'm telling you, I had several people asking me about what I was going to do. Amen. I know who I married. I married up, and I married some help. But it is such an honor to have Brother and Sister Tony with us. So whenever we get done singing this song, I want him to come take his liberty. And I want us to get behind Brother Tony. And I know he's got a word for us, a word for our church. And we're just excited to have them in Boonville. Amen. But why don't we all stand together again? We're going to sing this song as we prepare our hearts for the word. What great words and that we've already heard spoken. Amen. The presence of the Lord is moving. And so I want to encourage you, don't leave the same way. I know we say that a lot, but don't let this be just another service. I know there might be, I know it's a little different dynamic when there's guests here, and maybe if you're a guest here tonight, maybe there's a little different, you say, well, I don't want anybody thinking, just, you're in a safe place tonight. Amen. So I encourage you right now, just make up your mind, God, I'm going to be sensitive to what you want to do in my life, and I'm going to be sensitive in what you want to do in my heart tonight. Amen. Let's worship the Lord together.
Down to their fears and dry tears. For any victory song, well then you'll understand the reason for the way the saints of God may carry on.
When I shout, no, I'm shouting from a heart that's been washed clean. When I run, no, I'm running from a cash that's been reading. To the world it might look crazy, there's just no telling what you're gonna do. Moment Jesus gets a hold of you. Every breath's another chance to testify. When I shout, no, I'm shouting from a heart that's been washed clean. When I run, no, I'm running from a past that's been reading. To the world it might look crazy, there's just no telling what you're gonna do. In that moment, Jesus gets a hold.
Clap our hands to the Lord and give him a shout of praise. There's nobody like you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Amen. That's one of my favorite songs. Amen. There's no telling what you'll do when the Holy Ghost will get a hold of you. People look at us Pentecostals like we're crazy, but there's just no telling what you'll do when the Holy Ghost gets a hold of you. Grab your Bibles while you're standing and let's go to the book of 1 Samuel chapter number 22, and it is such an honor. It really wasn't planned for us to be here per se, but it worked out. And so when I knew I was going to be in Mississippi, I called Brother and Sister Soden and asked them if maybe it would work out for us to stop by. I didn't have to preach. I just wanted to come and be in service with the Sodans. They are some great people. You are blessed to have this couple as your pastor. And Caden and Noah are just great kids. They're the first kids that I know of that called us Papa and Nana T. And so they're like our grandbabies without being our grandbabies. And so we're excited about seeing them. And this Wednesday's 14 years of marriage. I lost money on that bet. I didn't think he'd put up with her 6 months, but we're actually here to do some marriage counseling for him because things are struggling, and tell the truth and shame the devil. Amen. 1 Samuel chapter number 22. Behind every church, there is a story behind the story, if I could say it like that. Our church in Omaha is successful because of Crystal, at the time, Lockwood joining us and helping us. That was the only team we had. It was us, me, my wife, our nine-month-old daughter, and shortly after that, Crystal joined us. And I can honestly say there is a church in Omaha, Nebraska, because of your pastor's wife coming to help serve and to work, and she would do anything that we needed her to do, and we give her honor. And then when Jonathan joined her, it was just a great, great time. We didn't want him to live with us when he moved there, but it didn't look good for him to live with her yet, and so we just felt like that's what we probably should do. And then he mentioned our church in Lexington. I can probably count, give you three names of people why there is a church in Lexington. And one of those names is Brother Billy Patton, and he is here tonight. And so I give you honor. Thank you for loving my family, and thank you for being kind to our church so very, very much. Amen. And Sister Soden preached today, and so I have to follow that. And I have some issues with that. 1 Samuel chapter number 22, we're just going to read one verse. Then I'm going to announce a title that's going to sound very strange. That's not going to sound like it matches anything. And if everything lines up the way it's supposed to, we'll understand it better by and by. And the king said to Doeg, "Turn thou and fall upon the priest." And Doeg the Edomite turned and fell. Be careful when people start telling you to turn on the priest. And he fell upon the priest and slew on that day 85 persons. Now check this out. That did wear a linen ephod. It wasn't just anyone claiming to be a priest. It was those that wore a particular garment. He said, you kill those priests. You turn on those priests. My sermon tonight is the assassination of JFK. Seriously, that's what I want to preach for a few minutes. You're looking at me like, what? No, seriously, look at your neighbor and say, that's what he's really going to preach. The assassination of JFK. God bless you. May be seated, Brother Soden. It's so good to be with you. I love you, man. I love you and respect you. It was Monday morning, March 30th, 1981. I just finished reading a book about Ronald Reagan. And on that particular morning, President Ronald Reagan was leaving a hotel in D.C. when a deranged drifter by the name of John Hinckley Jr. began his assassination attempt. He fired six shots from a .22 caliber revolver, and one of the bullets entered into President Reagan's chest, puncturing a lung and lodging only an inch from his heart. The president, then Reagan, was rushed to George Washington Hospital for an emergency surgery. He told the doctors on the way into the operating room, he looked at them and said, "I sure hope all of you are Republicans today." He eventually made a full recovery. However, sometimes assassination attempts turn into reality, such as it did on November the 22nd, 1963. And some of you that are old enough will remember right where you were when you heard the news with the murdering of John Fitzgerald Kennedy, the 35th president of the United States of America. He had hardly been in office for 1,000 days when an assassin's bullet would pierce his body in downtown Dallas, and there he would die. Lee Harvey Oswald was later convicted as the person who pulled the trigger in killing the president. But let's just talk about the elephant in the room for a minute, because the assassination of JFK has spurred numerous conspiracy theories. Now, we're not going to dive into that, but just while we're here, such things as accusations of involvement from the CIA, the mafia, the UPC, no, not the UPC, sorry about that, setting Vice President Lyndon Johnson, said some say they had something to do with it, Cuban Prime Minister Fidel Castro, the KGB, the list goes on and on. But at the end of the day, JFK was assassinated. Somebody say assassination. Now, usually people kill other people because they don't like them, or because they are jealous of them, or maybe they fear them, or they are intimidated by them. That's who people are targeted when it comes to murder. That's why the Bible says that the thief cometh not, but for to steal, to kill, and to destroy. It is the devil's wish and his desire and his want to assassinate every one of us who are trying our best to live for God. He may not kill us physically, but if he can kill us spiritually, then he has done more than just kill our soul. Jesus said, fear not the man that can just kill your body. He said, but you might want to pay attention to those that can kill both the soul and the body. And it is the devil's desire to kill and destroy and steal from every one of us. That's why you can be in the world and the devil not mess with you. But the moment you make up your mind that you're going to live for God, all hell can start breaking loose in your life. That's why it seems like everything can go wrong once you begin and you start trying to become faithful to church, because the devil wants to destroy you. He wants to kill you. He wants to rob you of every blessing and every promise that God has ever given you or will give you. And when you get in that, you'll start scanning the church, and you'll look at your attack, and you'll start scanning the church, and you'll start analyzing everything and everybody. I'm sure y'all don't do that here, but they do that occasionally in Florida. And they start analyzing everything and everybody in the church, and they start looking around and saying things like, well, that family isn't under attack. And that person, well, they seem to be doing good, and so God must love them more than he loves me. First of all, you don't have a clue as to what people are really going through. Every one of us, look at your neighbor and say, that includes you. Every one of us have been under the attack of the enemy at some point or another. The devil attacked the choicest and the best during the reign of Nebuchadnezzar, and he's still attacking the choice and the best today. And I want this to encourage somebody tonight. If all hell is breaking loose in your life, it's not because God hates you. It's because the devil is scared of you. It's not because God has turned his back to you. It's because he has put his hand on you, and the devil is afraid and worried. You're going through those problems right now, not because God has deserted you, but because the devil is intimidated by you. And that's why he's trying his best to steal, kill, and destroy. The devil wants you to quit. The devil wants you to hang up your harp on the willow. The devil wants you to sit down and cry about your situation, because he knows if we keep doing what we're doing, and if we keep fighting the good fight of faith, we're going to pull down every stronghold, and we're going to shake the very foundations of hell, and we're going to take back everything that the devil has stolen from us. You better believe the devil's trying to stop the church. You better believe the devil's trying to get the church divided. You better listen, the biggest thing about COVID that I'm worried about is the division, not the disease. It's trying to get us divided. But I come to tell you right now, you better not be ignorant of the devil's devices, because the devil knows if there ever rises up one church that's unified, that's bought by the blood of Jesus Christ, he is scared to death of a one God, apostolic Jesus name church.
The devil is intimidated by worshipers. The devil is intimidated by people who are going through hell, but they still clap their hands and they still shout amen and they're still faithful to the things of God. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
So I'm going to just kind of plow here for a few minutes and give you a little Bible lesson concerning Esau. We're familiar with Jacob. We do a lot of preaching about Jacob, but let's talk for a few minutes about Esau. Esau was the eldest son of Isaac. The oldest always got the birthright and the blessing. But Esau sealed his fate when he traded his birthright for a bowl of soup. Boy, when you start thinking carnal, you can justify anything. His thinking was so skewed, he was like, I'm going to die. So what good is a birthright going to do? So I'm going to die anyhow. Give me a bowl of soup. Well, look stupid. If you get, sorry, look, dummy, I got that mantle of Jeff Arnold on me. I'm going to try to get that off of me right here. I'm so sorry. If you're about to eat and get revived and refreshed, you're not going to die. So you're about to give away your birthright for a bowl of soup. Because when we're carnal, our thinking is skewed. And then we know He sold his birthright to his brother, and then Jacob tricked their blind and elderly father into giving him Esau's blessing. Esau had a few problems going for him. He wasn't as dedicated as he needed to be, and he was very hairy. I mean, you know you're hairy when mama has to kill a goat and put the hair of a goat on your arms. You're looking at me like I'm making that up. That is in your Bible. Go read your Bible. Has to put a hair of a goat on it. You know you need to get a number three on and just do work. Anyhow, and so Jacob tricked their blind, dying father into blessing him. And now thinking Esau's going to kill him, Jacob escapes to go live with his mother's relatives in Haran to get away from his brother's wrath. I want you to notice here, Esau sold his birthright. He did that. And then he got mad because daddy couldn't bless him the way he wanted to be blessed. How many times have we easily given up what was rightfully ours, and then we got mad at God for not blessing us the way we thought he should bless us? I just want to tell somebody tonight, don't give up. I just want to tell somebody tonight, don't give in. Don't trade in that birthright just yet. I know you're tired. I know you're weak. I know you don't see a way out, but I'm telling you, just give God another day. Esau hated his brother. I know they embraced years later and they wept, and you know, Esau supposedly forgave Jacob, but he never got over what happened to him. The Bible tells us in Genesis chapter 36 that Esau moved to a place called Mount Seir. He got married, and listen, he became Edom. His descendants became the Edomites. Jacob forever remained a painful reminder of what Esau might have been. And that reminder spawned a bitterness that consumed Esau. Esau eventually renounced anything related to Jacob and to Israel. And over seven centuries of time, sometimes the seed of bitterness takes a little while to really grow into real hatred. But over 700 years of time, the disdain for anything spiritual had become pure hatred in the Edomites, especially one particular Edomite that we read in our text. His name was Doeg. Everybody say Doeg. In 1 Samuel chapter 22, bears record of the conflict between King Saul and David. And just so you know, I haven't forgotten about JFK. We're going to come back and get him in a minute. I just don't want you to think I forgot about it. By this time, David had been anointed. He had killed Goliath. He had gained a measure of popularity with the people. But instead of rewarding him, King Saul became increasingly jealous of David. What are you going to do when somebody comes in the church and they can sing better than you can sing? What are you going to do when somebody can come in, they can preach better than you can preach, and they can organize better than you can? You better be careful. There's a Saul living in every one of us. And Saul got jealous of David. And so if you do a little homework in 1 Samuel chapters 19 through 28, you'll see the pursuit of Saul to kill David. During one of the pursuits, David goes and he visits Ahimelech, the priest. Ahimelech did three things for David, like every good priest should, every good preacher should. He prayed for him. He gave him hallowed bread. Then he gave him Goliath's sword. Unfortunately, King Saul had a spy watching all this. That spy's name was Doeg. Doeg comes back and reports to King Saul, and Saul accuses Ahimelech of conspiring against him and working with David, who of course had done nothing to Saul. And in a fit of rage, Saul summoned all the priests who had gathered at a place called Nob for a time of praise and worship. He said, I want to see all the priests. I want you to come before me and appear before me. Ahimelech tried his best to explain the meeting to King Saul, but all of his attempts were futile. King Saul was beyond the point of reason, and he immediately judged the priests and found them guilty and sentenced them to die. And the Bible says that King Saul turned to his soldiers and said, turn, slay them. The Lord, because their hand is with David. Don't slay them because they've done something wrong. Just slay them because they're more loyal to somebody else. And the Bible says they refused. They wasn't going to get part of that. They weren't going to be part. So eventually, he turned to Doeg, who was waiting like a dog, waits for his master to say attack. And Saul gave the word, and the Bible says that Doeg, the Edomite, turned and fell upon the priest and slew on that day 85 persons that did wear a linen ephod. Notice who he targeted. Notice who he assassinated. The priests who were wearing a linen ephod. A linen ephod was a garment of praise. So the scripture more modernly translates like this. Doeg the Edomite turned and fell upon the priest and killed on that day 85 priests of praise. Doeg's job was simple. Kill the praisers. Assassinate the ones who are worshiping the Lord. And that's exactly the spirit that the devil is still working under today. Do whatever you got to do. Kill the praisers. Satan wants to kill your praise. He wants to steal your worship. He wants to destroy your relationship with God. Come on, some of you have been going through some stuff and you're wondering, why am I going through this? Because there's a spirit that's trying to assassinate your praise and your worship. Because if you don't praise God, you cannot get through this on your own. I heard the man say, your strength ain't good enough by itself. If you don't learn how to praise God, there's just some stuff you're not going to get through. That's why the Bible says that the very first thing that the devil got permission to attack on Job was his cattle. It wasn't his kids. It wasn't his money. It was his livestock. And the reason why that's important is because the way you worship God in Job's day was through animal sacrifice. And what the devil was saying is, if I can take away his ability to worship God, he will curse God and die. And the devil's been trying that same tactic ever since. He keeps trying to take away our ability to worship God. But you got to make up your mind, come hell or high water, I am going to praise the Lord. This is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in. The devil doesn't mind you coming to church as long as you don't get in church. And the devil may not even mind you getting in church as long as the church don't get in you. He doesn't mind you getting around this. He just doesn't want you to get to the place where you realize there's power in praise. And you can understand that you can have victory and you can be delivered and you can. He doesn't want you to get there. He doesn't mind you coming to church, hearing about it. He doesn't mind you experiencing a few goosebumps here and there, maybe even getting your tongue tied up every once in a while. But he does not want you to ever go beyond the veil where it's more than just some noise. And now it becomes true worship, because then you can realize that you can be set free and you can be delivered and you don't have to live like that. I know this may not be deep, but I'm not trying to blow smoke with you tonight either. The devil wants to kill your praise. Because if you ever stop praising him, your relationship with God is taking a downward spiral. Let me remind you a little bit about the devil. When Satan or Lucifer was in heaven, he was the priest of praise. He was the leader of praise. The only one higher than him was God. But he wasn't satisfied with that. He wanted to be like God. He wanted to be the one receiving the praise. So when he tried to be like God and rise above God, listen to me, he forfeited his birthright. And he was cast out of heaven. Much like Esau having to leave the promised land and going to Mount Seir. I want you to get this. There's an eerie connection between Satan and his angels and Esau and the Edomites. They both hate praise and worship. That's why when Jesus was born, King Herod tried to kill all the male babies in an attempt to kill Jesus. Why? Because Herod was a descendant of the Edomites. And Doeg killed the priest of praise. Herod tried to kill our reason for praise. So I'm just going to plow one more time and tell you, the devil is trying his best to steal our praise and steal our worship and destroy our relationship with God. Because if he can kill your praise, then he's got your joy and he's got your happiness. And eventually he'll destroy everything else connected to you. We cannot allow a spirit of Doeg to enter into the 21st century apostolic church. We cannot allow anything to kill our praise and worship. He wants to assassinate you. He wants to kill you. He wants to destroy you. But you got to learn how to praise God in all. It's still okay to clap your hands. It's still okay to stomp your feet every once in a while. It's still okay to run the aisles and worship God. The hour cometh and now is when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. The assassination of JFK. Now, I'm not talking about the 35th president of the United States, if you haven't already picked that up. The JFK that the enemy's trying to assassinate is our joy, our faith, and our kingdom-mindedness. There are way too many joyless Pentecostal people. I don't even know if that's a word, but we're going to make it one tonight. There are way too many joyless Pentecostal people. Webster defines the term joy as the emotion evoked by well-being, success, or good fortune, or by the prospect of possessing what one desires. How can we be Holy Ghost filled and not have joy. Too many Christians walk around with their head hung low. No smile, no joy, no happiness, no hope, nothing but doubt, despair, and discouragement. And yet they wonder why they can't win anybody. Nobody wants what you have when you look like that. Nobody wants what you have when you look like you've been baptized in vinegar, sucking on a sour pickle, and acting like everybody in the world's against you. Our joy, you know what 2020 tried to do? It tried to assassinate our joy. It tried to get fear to step in and make us worry and get guilt on us and fear and being afraid and worried about this and worried about that. We don't have time for this. Listen, our joy has been assassinated. No wonder the Bible says the joy of the Lord is my strength. Every once in a while, you just got to put the devil in his place. You got to turn off the news. You got to close every negative voice that's trying to get in your head, because it will zap every bit of joy you've got. And you got to find a place to get along with God and begin to count back all the great things that God has done. And it may not have been a great year in 2020, but we're still here. Some of your praise has been under attack. Because if he can get you from worshiping, then your joy falls. Your joy is assassinated. And if your joy dies, your strength will vanish. David hit the nail on the head when he said in Psalms 51 and verse 12, "Restore unto me the joy of what? Thy salvation." No blessings, no money. No prosperity, none of this, none of that. He said, just let me get back to where there's a restoration of the joy that I'm just saved. I want to take about 30 seconds, and if you've got the Holy Ghost, and if you've been born again, and if you've been baptized in His name, I'm not saying that things are not bad in your life. I'm not saying you don't have reason to be upset. But I am saying, God, restore unto us the joy of salvation. I'm just glad I'm saved. I may not know how I'm going to pay my bills, but I'm saved. I may not know what they're going to find on that x-ray, but I'm saved. I may not know what happens tomorrow, but my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And Jesus said, don't rejoice because you got power over the enemy. He said, rejoice because your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Just glad I'm saved. May get up in the morning and fight a devil, but I'm glad I'm saved. Things may not be perfect, but I'm still here. That ought to make me smile on a Sunday night. You may have sickness and disease, but you're still here. That ought to put a little smile on your face on a Sunday night. Things may not be perfect, but I promise you they could be a lot worse. We need to restore the joy of salvation back to our lives. Thank God we're saved. We may be poor, but we're saved. We may not have everything we want, but we're saved. No weapon formed against me. It didn't say no weapon would be formed. Listen, my wife could get up here and preach this a lot better than I can, because she is like, joy is her candy stick. Just too many unhappy people. And when you're unhappy, you're not fun to be around. And it's like one domino that touches every other domino. It affects everything. What? All the men, help me out. Help me preach right here. If you're a man here, I want you to help me preach. Happy wife. Because happiness touches everything. I'm not saying put your head in the sand and act like things are not there, but I am saying there's times to cry, but there's also times to dry our tears and say the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. I've got weapons being formed against me, but I choose not to let them prosper, because greater is He that's in me than he. Devil, you may huff and puff and you may try to blow this house down, but you cannot knock me out. You cannot destroy my relationship. You're not going to assassinate my joy. Somebody shout amen. Can't let the devil assassinate your joy. The next thing the devil's after is our faith. Is our faith. The Bible says, when the Lord returns, shall He find faith on the earth? That lets me know that faith is going to be a premium when the Lord comes. You may have to fight for it, but fight the good fight of faith. Too many of us, 2020 has killed our faith. We used to believe God. We used to step out on faith. We used to know that God can do anything. But now we're scratching our head in unbelief and we're wondering what's going on here, because your faith has been assassinated and you're catching yourself. You don't believe anymore. Actually, you're being cynical a little bit. You're kind of mocking what the preacher's saying. You're kind of saying, well, we've heard that before. God hasn't done this before. God hasn't done that. Where's your faith? We cannot grow the kingdom of God without faith. We cannot see signs, wonders, and miracles unless we have faith. We cannot see people delivered from their sins unless somebody in the church operates in the realm of faith. We cannot see people receive the Holy Ghost unless we have faith. If there's any sick among you, let them call for the elders of the church and anointing with oil the prayer of the what? Faith. Don't lay hands on anybody if you're a doubting Thomas. When you lay hands on somebody, you're imparting what you have. You're usurping authority over their situation. When you lay hands on somebody's head, head is authority. When you lay hands, the Bible says, lay hands on no man suddenly. You got to be careful when you start imparting stuff to people. Because if you're not where you need to be, and listen, don't pray for me. If I'm dying, I don't need you that's full of doubt to pray for me. I got that. I need somebody with faith. I need somebody that says, I know what the doctor's report said. I know what it looks like. I know that runs in your family. I know your daddy may have died from that and your brother may have died from that. I just believe, though, that God is about to do. That's who I want praying for me. You see, I believe God wants to step in this house on a Sunday night, and if you're sick in your body, I believe He wants to heal you, but that can only happen if our faith is not killed and if our faith is not assassinated. I believe somebody may have walked in this house and you're addicted to some things you don't need to be addicted to. Well, I believe that God can touch you and deliver you tonight, but it can only happen if our faith has not been assassinated. You may have walked in sick, but you can walk out. You can walk out healed. You may have walked in bound, but you can walk out set free. God wants to heal our faith tonight. We will. Well, look at this beautiful building. But what if God's got another building? I know we got a little COVID spacing going on here. I get that. But what if when that's over, and we put the other chairs in, what if it still looks like this? What if we go, well, we got to do that. You can't do that with doubt. You say, yeah, but we had a good service last week. Just because you had a good service doesn't mean doubt's not in the room. Now check this out. Mark chapter 6 says that Jesus could do no mighty work except
lay hands on a few sick folk and healed them. I thought you just said he couldn't do a mighty work. So here's what I deduce from that. That a few sick people being healed doesn't equal a mighty work. Now, if a few people get healed tonight, I know what we're going to do. We're going to post it on Facebook. We're going to shout about it. Hey, look what God said. I can do that when there's just doubt in the room. I can do that when there's unbelief in the room. I can do that when you don't even believe me. So let's not just get happy and shouting about two or three things happening good here or there. That doesn't mean we're operating in faith. Jesus wants us to get to the place where our faith is so big, it's so revived and so restored that everybody that's sick can get healed, and everybody that's lost can get saved, and everybody that's bound can get... Come on, I believe we can build the kingdom of God and build this church bigger, but it's got to come by faith. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word. Don't let the devil destroy your joy. Don't let the devil assassinate your faith. And I had no idea that Brother Patton was going to be here tonight. I had no idea. He didn't even text me and forewarn me. It aggravates me. People just sneaking up behind you and stuff. What I love about this man, I promise you, and I'm not embarrassing him, but since he's here, that's what he gets for not telling me. You're not going to meet a more kingdom-minded man. We cannot do what God has called us to do if the enemy assassinates our joy, our faith, or our kingdom-mindedness. This is not about us. This is about the kingdom of God. And the kingdom of God is bigger than us. Whatever the biggest thing you can imagine, God's bigger. We have the truth. I believe that wholeheartedly. I believe what we preach is the truth. I don't believe that we are just a church. I honestly believe we are the church. If I believed we were like every other church in town, I wouldn't do what I do. But I don't believe we're like every other church. I believe we have the truth. And we better be able to rise up and do everything that God wants us to do, regardless of the cost, regardless of the discomfort that it might bring us. We have a world to reach, and God has given us power to reach the world. But the devil would love for us just to focus on me, mine, and ours. He would love to assassinate kingdom mindedness, because if we're not kingdom minded, guess what? We become selfish. We become self-centered. And then we become self-righteous. And then we'll start wanting to be served rather than finding somebody else to serve. Let me give you a few little things here. Let me give you some qualities of kingdom-minded people. Kingdom-minded people don't find fault in everything that goes on. It doesn't mean they like everything. It doesn't even mean they agree with everything. It doesn't mean that's the way they would do it. But kingdom-minded people say, all right, let's try it. Kingdom-minded people are people who are not wanting to be served, but they're wanting to serve. Kingdom-minded people are people who are not seeking the bright lights, but they're willing to go in the highways and byways and compel others to come in. Kingdom-minded people are people who could care less who sits on the right or the left. They just want to make sure that people are being born again. Kingdom-minded people are not turned off if a certain preacher isn't preaching. Kingdom-minded people are still going to be faithful when everybody else quits. Kingdom-minded people are going to be people who will pay their tithes even if it causes great sacrifices. Kingdom-minded people are people who are not easily shaken with every wind of doctrine or seed of gossip.
Kingdom-minded people are people who test the spirits to make sure that they are from God. And if they are not, then they refrain from being around such. Kingdom-minded people don't have to be pumped up and primed up when it comes to worshiping God. They just walk. I feel like I'm around some kingdom-minded people because you're an easy bunch of people to preach to. You know why? Because you got your mind on something greater than just this. I'm afraid the church in America has gotten so fat and lazy and comfortable and complacent that we've turned the church into the love boat when it's supposed to be a battleship. Until every soul in Boonville has repented and been baptized in Jesus' name and filled with the Holy Ghost, we don't have any reason not to think about the kingdom of God. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness and everything. We've got to get back to where the kingdom of God is our number one priority. Let's all stand. For the kingdom of God is not meat nor drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. The assassination of JFK. If I had to say 2020 did anything, it tried to kill our joy. It tried to assassinate our faith. And it tried to get us to just focus on us. Joy, faith. Kingdom-mindedness. Doeg killed everyone that wore a linen ephod. Let me ask you an important question tonight. What kills your praise? Doeg used a sword to kill the priest of praise. However, Satan is more subtle. But whatever he uses, God gives you a defense for it. You don't have to allow that Edomite to destroy your praise. If he uses guilt or condemnation to destroy your praise, then your best defense is repentance. If he uses your past sins in your life, then your best defense is Jesus' name baptism. If he uses the hypocrisy of religion to hold you back, then your best defense is the baptism of the Holy Ghost. If he uses hurt and bitterness to take away your praise, your best defense is forgiveness. If he uses weariness, then your best defense is to cast all your care upon him because he cares for you. Whatever he accuses you of, just remember God has already excused you of. The bottom line is this: hell can only kill and assassinate your praise if you let it. Choose you this day whom you will serve. But as for me and my house, we're going to choose. It may not always be easy. It may not always be comfortable. But we're going to choose to serve the Lord. You know, really, I guess what I'm saying is this. Through it all, through the ups and the downs, through the disappointments, you got to hang on to your joy. You can bury loved ones and cry, but still have the joy of the Lord in your heart at the same time. I'm not talking about some silly laughter that excuses reality. I'm not saying that. I'm talking about an internal peace. Like Job, though he slay me. Through it all. Through it all. I'm just going to make up my mind. I refuse to let the enemy assassinate my joy, my faith, my kingdom-mindedness. Listen, I don't know this because of anything Brother Sister Soden has said. I know this because I've been pastoring for 21 years. There are people that's not doing all they can do for the kingdom of God because of something from yesterday. I'm asking you, get your eyes off of yourself. And just make up your mind through it all. Somebody shout, through it all.
through it all, I'm just gonna worship God. I'm gonna make up my mind that nothing is going to kill my praise. Now, I believe what I'm about to say. I don't believe in promoting hypocrisy, but I don't believe in only coming to church when everything's perfect in your life either. So I think what we have believed to be hypocrisy probably isn't hypocrisy. Hypocrisy is when you intentionally put on a face to look this way, and then when you're around, it's like an actor on a stage. It's where you're intentionally doing things. I'm not saying that hypocrisy is not the same thing as falling and stumbling and getting up and coming back to church. The devil says you're a hypocrite when you do that. I say you're a just man. We got a lot of holiness standards in the church, but the one that never hardly ever gets talked about is the Bible says a righteous man, a just man, falls seven times and he gets back up. If you're going to really be righteous, you got to learn how to get back up. So I believe what I'm about to say, that you don't have to be perfect, whatever that looks like, to lift up your hands and worship God. So as a matter of fact, the Bible tells us the qualifications of people to praise the Lord. This is what it says. This is what it says. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Because you may be breathing and may be a heathen. You may be breathing and may be a sinner. You may be breathing and may be addicted. But if you'll go ahead and start praising God, that praise is going to... It's not in my notes, but I said it this morning preaching, so I'm going to say it now. When they threw Joseph in the pit, out of all the brothers who came and negotiated his release from the pit, out of the 10 brothers that could have came and made a pitch, the one who came and said, let's get him out of there and let's sell him, which actually put him back on the road to his promise, was the brother named Judah. And Judah means what? Praise Judah negotiated him out of the pit. And praise Judah put him back on the road to fulfill his destiny. And praise has been pulling people out of the pit ever since. And praise has been putting people on the right road ever since. I just stopped by tonight to tell somebody, don't let the devil kill your joy. Don't let the devil kill your worship. Don't let the devil kill your faith. Don't let the devil kill your kingdom-mindedness. I want you to throw your hands up all over this place. I want them to sing this song, this chorus, a time or two. And if the Holy Ghost starts moving, I don't know what your protocol is, so I don't want to do anything you're not supposed to do. But if you can come to the front, or if you can step out in your aisle, as they just begin to sing this through it all, if your mind's made up that I'm not going to let him destroy me, I'm not going to let this situation assassinate my joy.
I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God.
Come on, that's it.
Lord, heaven and claim it.